Welcome to worship. I'm glad that you're here. I have several announcements to share with you this morning. Today, starting today, we are going to add a layer into the passing of the peace. Part of the feedback that we've been getting is that everyone sitting out there is just always passing the peace to me. And we want you to pass the peace to one another without getting up and moving around and shaking hands. So we're going to try that today of just turning to neighbors, especially when we get to the part, and with you, and with you. So we'll try that this morning. Yeah, waiting always helps me. I mean, you know, if this messes you up, then how you can do peace as well. A reminder, session is meeting this Wednesday evening at 7. If you're an elder sitting in the pews, make yourself a reminder. And then nominating committee is also called a meeting for 6 o'clock this Wednesday before session meets. We have some special music to look forward to in 2 weeks. Thanks, Phil, for lining that up. Another way that we can enjoy music, so something we've been missing. Jim asked me this morning if I would remind the men who are here that you have a breakfast next Saturday at 8 o'clock. Pastoral concerns that I would share with you. We had a lovely, lovely wedding here yesterday. Emily Harkey and Mitchell Beaverson went off without a hitch for the most part, and it was just lovely. But a special, special thank you to Ken and to Deb Bickerstaff who were here working and helping, to Lisa Gillen and to Byron who came back after the wedding was all over. Because everything here got switched out, decorated, and we undecorated. Not we, they undecorated and got it back ready for worship. It's a lot of work to do to switch things back around. So thank you, thank you, thank you that you have it ready for us this morning to worship. And yes, thank you. There are some birthdays coming up this week. Kay Smith and D.Y. have birthdays at the end of this week. And so what we're asking, I guess coming out of the deacons is a special request. Please, please, please send cards if you can to each of these this week, because they are not going to be able to have a lot of visitors to come and help celebrate their birthdays. So that would be great. There is a prayer request from Kathy Stewart that you pray for a little baby named Mason. This is connected to a cousin of hers. Mason is the only living right now infant of a set of triplets who were born. And so for Mason and for his family, lift up some prayers. It's scary and hard times for that family. The others, I want to give you the word that Sam Rye has been admitted into St. Joseph's Hospital in Ann Arbor, and he is in room 670. Again, visitors aren't really allowed, one person a day, and so we want to let that be family. So please don't head up there, but prayers for Sam Rye, and if you are friends with Pat or Sam, you might want to reach out, okay? I think those are all the announcements this morning, and we are ready for the Christ light to be brought in. Okay, here we go. Passing out peace. Okay? Remember, it's fine. Peace. That's peace. Be with you. Now, face each other. Turn around. And with you. And with you. Amen. See? That way you got to see each other, whether you wave or you high five or however. Please join me as we call ourselves to worship. People of God, bless the Lord.
It is God who saves, God who forgives, and God who delivers.
Great is God's steadfast love for us.
We give thanks and praise to God's holy name.
confess our sins together. We bow before your judgment, O God. Have mercy on us as we confess our sins. We base too many decisions on the faulty standards of our society rather than on your word. Forgive us when we are willing to overlook our own faults as we point out the faults of others. Forgive us for our lack of imagination to envision a world ruled by your love. Have mercy on us, we pray. I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. Horse and rider he has thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my might, and has become my salvation. This is my God, and I will praise him, my Father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a warrior, the Lord is his name. Pharaoh's chariots and his army God has cast into the sea. His picked officers were sunk in the Red Sea. The floods covered them. They went down into the depths like a stone. Your right hand, O Lord, glorious in power, your right hand, O Lord, shattered the enemy. In the greatness of your majesty, you overthrew your adversaries. You sent out your fury, it consumed them like stubble. and the blast of your nostrils, the waters piled up, the floods stirred up in a heap, the deeps congealed in the heart of the sea. The enemy said, I will pursue, I will overtake, I will divide the spoil, my desire shall have its fill of them. I will draw my sword, my hand shall destroy them. You blew your wind, the sea covered them. They sank like lead in the mighty waters. Who is like you, O Lord, among the gods? Who is like you, majestic in holiness, awesome in splendor, doing wonders? Then the prophet Miriam, Aaron's sister, took a tambourine in her hand, and all the women went out after her with tambourines and with dancing. And Miriam sang to them, sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. Horse and rider he has thrown into the sea. This is the reading of God's holy word. This is the word of the Lord, the word of life.
Thanks be to God.
A young boy was asked by his mother what he had learned in Sunday school that morning. And the 10-year-old began, well, our teachers told us about when God sent Moses behind enemy lines to rescue the Israelites from the Egyptians. But then, when they came to the Red Sea, Moses called for the engineers to build a pontoon bridge, and after they crossed it, they looked back and saw the Egyptian tanks coming. Quick as a flash, Moses radioed headquarters to send some bombers to blow up the bridge and save the Israelites. Is that really the way your teacher taught you that story? His mother asked. Well, not exactly, the little boy said, but if I told it her way, you would never believe it. Right? It's an incredible story. It's an amazing incident in the life of God's people. Late night flight, fleeing Pharaoh's army, God's mighty hand at work to save and protect them. Our Hebrew ancestors remember this portion of their history with awe and with wonder. Here's a miracle that's impossible to explain. And yet, I have heard dozens of attempts at explanations, from trying to calculate how the tides played a part, the winds, to tectonic shifts under the Earth's surface. These all miss the point. I think the point of the story is that they were standing at the edge of the sea with water before them, seeing Pharaoh's chariots bearing down on them, and the Hebrews feel hopeless. And really, they are. That's a key part of the story. There is nothing that they can do to save themselves. Their freedom is precarious. Their faith tenuous. They stood on the edge of the sea and could not do anything. The power lies with God. It is God's mighty hand that comes to their defense, fighting on their behalf. The writer of Exodus is not trying to explain what happened. The writer is trying to bear witness to this mighty and awesome thing that God has done. The writer of Exodus proclaims that God and God alone defines what is just and what is possible. We know that we have stepped into an ongoing story, and a lengthy saga when we come to this story of the Hebrews crossing the Red Sea. And from the beginning of the story, when Moses is placed by his mother in a reed basket and hidden in the bulrushes for Pharaoh's daughter to find, we also know that God's mighty hand has been moving throughout this story. God's hand at work when Moses fled Egypt after standing for the slaves against another Egyptian. God's hand was at work when Moses noticed the burning bush and was sent back to Egypt to confront Pharaoh. When Moses and his brother Aaron confronted Pharaoh the first time, well, things didn't go so well. The Lord says to let my people go. Never heard of him, Pharaoh says. And as a result of Moses' first request, Pharaoh just figured the Israelites had too much time on their hands, and so he gave them more work to do. But God's mighty hand is at work, and God promises deliverance in spite of Pharaoh's power. One of the most lopsided contests in history began when Moses and Aaron returned to Pharaoh and confronted the most powerful man in that world. The battle of the plagues included blood and frogs and gnats and flies and boils and hail and locusts. And while all the advisors of Pharaoh were begging him to give in to the Lord and let the people go, Pharaoh's heart was hardened. Then there were the last two plagues. First, a dense darkness that covered the land for 3 days, and then the final horrible plague, the death of the firstborn child of every Egyptian family. During that horrible night, when there was wailing in every home in Egypt, Pharaoh finally called Moses and told him to go. Leave my people, you and the Israelites. Go. Worship the Lord as you have requested. Can you imagine the chaos? This is it. Let's go. Hurry, hurry. We must hurry. It was late. People had grabbed what they could. They had one night to break the bonds of slavery that had held them for almost 400 years. It was now or never. But it must have been frightening. At any moment, Pharaoh could change his mind. Hurry, hurry, we must hurry. You can hear men yelling to their wives and mothers, coaxing their children, hurry, hurry, we must hurry. They had to make for the sea. The sea was their only chance. They couldn't take the straight road to Canaan. That way might have been quicker, but they would have had to pass 6 different heavily armed Egyptian outposts. That way was paved so the chariots could have traveled it easily. No, their only hope was the wilderness of Sinai, and to get there, they must go by sea. What they would do when they got there, nobody knew. And so the people fled, running into the night until they came to an abrupt halt at the edge of the sea. They could see the dust of Pharaoh's chariots in the distance, and still they hugged the edge of the water. They were terrified, crying out to Moses, "Why didn't we just stay in Egypt? Is this what all our running has been for? It would have been better to stay and serve Pharaoh than to drown and die here." But Moses gave them a great pep talk. He said, "Fear not. Stand firm, for Yahweh will fight for you. All You may not know how, you may not see the way, but all you have to do is trust. Have faith. Because even though it looks like all might be lost, our God is a God who makes a way out of no way. And so, Moses stretched out his hand like God instructed, and a way through the waters appeared. And the people, united as never before, quickly crossed the sea, which drew back just enough to let them through. When they reached the other side, when they looked behind them to check on the enemy, they are amazed. In astonishment, they see the Egyptians dead. Pharaoh's soldiers, Pharaoh's horses, Pharaoh's chariots, Pharaoh's power, Pharaoh's arrogance, all drowned in the Red Sea. A powerless people emerged victorious on the other side of the sea, and a powerful army is brought to nothing. God's victory was decisive. So awesome was this moment, so charged with faith and hope, that even the most skeptical saw within it the mystery of God's mighty hand at work. In a very powerful way, our Hebrew ancestors were taught that God, not Pharaoh, is in charge. When Moses and Miriam sing their songs of praise on the other side of the sea, it is of God's power and might that they sing. Yahweh, you stretched out your hand. You led forth. You guided. You redeemed. God was at work. And that was the result of seeing God's mighty hand at work. The Bible says that the people feared the Lord. The word fear in this translation of Hebrews means to revere the Lord, and believed in Yahweh. So I have a question for you. Who defines what is possible? Do the Pharaohs of the world? Or does God? My faith tells me that God is in control. But the world continually tries to tell me a different version of the truth. In hundreds of ways in modern society, we are told about strength and power. The Congress of the United States defines what is possible. A small group of multinational corporations determine the playing field. Our human institutions and systems set limits on what can be achieved. The legal system, the economy, our political system, they define what is possible. And how many times do we feel defeated or overwhelmed by letting that truth define us? As Christians, we have been given eyes of faith to see God's mighty hand at work in our lives and in the world around us, to see new possibilities when life is lived by faith. You might know the name Millard Fuller. He is a man who sees with the eyes of faith. He actually believes that it's possible to build enough housing so that every human being on the planet has a safe, warm place to call home. I wonder how many people have told him that it's impossible, and how many times his response has been that nothing is impossible with God. You might know his name, not know his name, but Fuller is the founder of Habitat for Humanity. And there is hardly a community in the United States that hasn't had people come together to build a habitat house. There's one being built right here in Adrian now. Second Harvest and Bread for the World are two national organizations that work to wipe out hunger. They believe that there is enough food in the world that no one should go hungry. It's been 6 months since things began to shut down in the face of COVID-19. So much has changed. So much has been lost. In light of this Exodus passage, I would ask us this morning, who's in charge? Right? And what is possible in the world today? Is a tiny virus in charge? Or is God in charge? Can we stand firm, trust, and be still waiting for God to work? Can we see God's mighty hand anywhere at work in the world, or in our lives, or in the church today? I believe with all my heart that God is in charge. I don't see how. I don't have the answers for the way forward. I feel like sometimes I'm standing on the edge with the sea in front of me and the army coming. And I don't know. Can we stand firm and trust and be still and wait for God's mighty hand to bring about whatever it is God might be working on? We can remain people of faith, even when we're right up to the edge of the water. This story from Exodus is for us both a witness and a summons, I think. It is a witness to the power of God, and it is a summons to faith that we too might open our eyes to see God's mighty hand at work among us, that we might join with Moses and Miriam, even now, in singing God's praise. Amen. If you would please join me as we say what we believe using your bulletin. It's printed there. We believe in one true and living God alone, whose demands on us are absolute, whose help for us is sufficient. That one is the Lord, whom we worship, serve, and love. We believe God works beyond our imagining throughout the universe. We acknowledge no other God. We must not set our reliance on any other help. We must not yield unconditional obedience to any other power. We must not love anyone or anything more than we love God. To worship God is highest joy. Join me in prayer. God of all goodness, we give thanks for your unfailing love towards your people. You led our ancestors with a pillar of cloud by day and fire by night. We pray that you would lead us through the threatening times of our lives. We gather in this place to honor you, for you are an awesome God. We bow before you in reverence and praise. We give you thanks that you have not left us alone in our attempts to be faithful, but have given us Christ Jesus, who shows us the way. Lord, you opened your arms for us on the cross, and you welcomed us into your kingdom. May your saving power be known among us, and lead us into the ways of peace and compassion. We give thanks for all that you have given to us. We pray that we would learn to neither hoard nor squander the gifts that you've given. As you have been generous with us, teach us how to be generous with others. As you grant us life day by day, help us to give our lives to you. Lord, we lay before you the concerns of our nation. We just marked the anniversary of 9/11. So help us to resolve to work for peace in the face of terrorism. Be with those who still grieve the loss of loved ones who died in New York, in Pennsylvania, and in Washington, D.C. We pray for soldiers still deployed on foreign soil. Lord, for all those who are in need of healing, in need of comfort, in need of compassion, may your presence be real to them. Help your people to reach out with an abundance of love and compassion in the face of need. We lay before you concerns for your church. May we be marked by your grace, that we might learn tolerance and forgiveness and respect of the other. We pray, Father, that we might witness your mighty hand at work in our community, with your light to guide us, with your hand to support us, with your love to surround us. We pray that you would lead us in the ways that you would have us go. United in your love, we unite our voices in prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen.
Can't hear you. God is in charge. Yes? So, we are asked to trust, to stand firm, and then to open our eyes, to look around and see where is God's mighty hand at work in our lives and in the world around us. Go out into the world as God's people, holding on to the faith that trusts that God is indeed at work. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.